So, hello everybody. I'm very happy to be here today in this university, and I would like to thank the European Liberal Forum, the Movimento Liberal Social, and the CADEM to have made that possible. The subject of my lecture will be the relevance of Adam Smith through to a present crisis. I will not speak about the present crisis itself, but I will try to pinpoint a few ideas of Adam Smith about capitalism in order to give you some elements to understand the present crisis in regards of the liberal doctrine. You will see that Adam Smith speaks a lot about Portugal in his book, and not in a very positive way, as you will see. Portugal is for him a good example of what we have not to do in an economical point of view. So I hope you won't be shocked by what was Adam Smith saying at the 18th century about the situation of your country. It doesn't criticize, of course, the Portuguese people. It doesn't criticize the Portuguese culture, but it criticizes a set of ideas which were popular in Portugal, but also in a lot of other countries in Europe at this period, and which has influenced the politics in this country. Anyway, you know that today Adam Smith is not really read, and it's quite rare when you see a sentence beginning with "to quote Adam Smith, ta-ta-ta." No, it never happens. It's a great pity, because for his Opus Magnus, is the very, very foundation of political economy in general, and of economic liberalism in particular. The economist Joseph Schumpeter, also a liberal economist, but who didn't share a lot of views with Adam Smith, wrote in the 50s in one of these books that the wealth of nation was, with The Origin of Species of Darwin, one of the best-selling book in the list of scientific books ever published. The history of and prosperity of sorry, and the posterity of this book make one wonder. One obscure professor of moral philosophy in a Scottish university undertakes to resolve a rather acute philosophical issue. At the beginning, Adam Smith is a philosopher, not an economist, because the discipline in itself was not a discipline, a field in academic structure at this time. So what is this philosophical problem? He wanted actually to find out how the unrestrained craving of some people for personal enrichment, considered by Aristotle as a destructive passion, could ever be considered compatible with the general interest. The very soonly argued answer to this philosophical question gave birth to contemporary political philosophy. Why? Because he created a lot of concepts, or he rephrased a lot of concepts which were existing at this time. I mean the capital, the concept of capital, the concept of price, the concept of value, the interest, the profit, the saving, the rent of land, the wage of labor, the division of labor, etc., etc. All those concepts are the founding tools of a practice which has been extended in the whole planet and will govern the life of nearly 7 billion of people today. The very existence of these persons today is largely considered as the consequence of the implementation of ideas contained in the works of Adam Smith. The transition from a subsistence economy to an economy of abundance is a consequence of the application of those ideas, and is the cause of the tremendous demographic boom. To have just an idea, when Adam Smith wrote his book, the entire population of the whole British Empire, I mean Great Britain, Ireland, America, and the West Indies, was estimated by himself as no more than 13 million people. Only slightly a bit more than the actual population of Portugal. So you had a really big demographic boom after this period. The book is published in 1767, and the success is spectacular. 10 years later, Adam Smith is considered as the highest authority of the Western world in economic field. He's the teacher of the public, of the students, and of the professor, who will teach his ideas in England and everywhere. William Pitt the Younger, who was Prime Minister of Great Britain at the end of the 19th century, will declare to Adam Smith, "You are the teacher of all of us." So at this time, the influence of economic policies could be compared to the influence of today Keynes, Hayek, or Friedman. So what was the world of Adam Smith? It was a world permanently at war, in a natural state of warfare in which Leviathans, so the big state, clashed every time. At that time, the territories that we know today as the United States were still British crown colonies that will eventually become independent 9 years after this book was published. Demographic growth in the rural states, always a reflection of a sound economy, was phenomenal in those days. While the European population doubled every 500 years at this period, the American population doubled every 25 years. So Adam Smith was a vibrant adversary of colonialism. He estimated that the secession of American colonies was highly probable, and he wanted to confer to the American colonies the right to trade with all the countries and the right to send representatives in the British Parliament. 70 years before Alexis de Tocqueville, Adam Smith was the first Western intellectual to give an example of what we will call later the American model. So I can speak also about another big countries at this period, which is the United Provinces. It was a very wealthy land with exceptional economic, colonial, and military powers, and it was the greatest and grandest oilier of Europe. So it was ferrying goods in every part of the world. The Dutch power was such that Cromwell, at this moment the Prime Minister of not really the Prime Minister, but the chief, the leader of Great Britain, in order to avoid the economic competition, adopted in 1651 the famous Navigation Act, which is the consecration of the protectionist. And this act is the beginning of four wars between the United Provinces and the Great Britain. So this war-mongering conception of trade was the consequence of what was then the dominant economic doctrine before Adam Smith. I mean the mercantilism, the true matrix of protectionist policies. Colbert, the prime minister of Louis XIV, was a mercantilist. It is under the influence of mercantilist ideas that France has engaged a war of custom tariffs, and this war of tariffs degenerated in a genuine military confrontation, the War of 40 Years. Louis XIV, a Catholic monarch of an agrarian country, felt personally humiliated by the fact that a Calvinist trading republic could accumulate so much wealth, colonies, and power. In those days, the Dutch Royal and Merchant Navies were superior to the French fleets, and the Dutch budget equaled that of France, whereas the Dutch population amounted only 2 million of persons, and in France it was 20 million persons. So in terms of wealth, Great Britain was second only to the United Provinces, but was nevertheless one of the most powerful states of the globe, and London the greatest trading capital of the whole world. Ireland and Great Britain were still two separate kingdoms, and it's interesting to know that the paper money was just appeared in Scotland 25 years before the publication of this book. Adam Smith explains in detail one of the first major financial crises, and is already perfectly conscient and has already identified the danger of an overabundant emission of bills by Scottish banks. France was undoubtedly one of the great powers of the era, but owing to the ancestral animosity between the two nations, and also because of mercantile partialities, Anglo-French trade suffered the bane of countless hindrance, whereas it could so easily have been a considerable source of prosperity for the two countries. Spain and Portugal were, at this period, among Europe's poorest nations in those days. According to Adam Smith, these ancient colonial power were over the hill, victims of what would later be coined as the Dutch disease, or in other words, the massive inflow of natural resources such as gold and silver. I just visited yesterday the Museo de Antigua Arte, and so I was impressed by the huge quantity of silver objects, silver made objects like caskets, candlesticks. And so you had a very massive flow from silver and gold in your country. But because of that, it's the interpretation of Adam Smith, they neglected their agriculture, their factories, or their trade. They have also lost the spirit of thrift. The spirit of thrift, which is an essentially vital quality for trading nation and peoples. You also the money squandering lifestyle of the monarchy, of its aristocracy, but also of its upper middle class that reminds us of the ways of present-day petro-monarchies. Left these countries drained at once, the demand for minted coinage was fully satisfied in Europe. Adam Smith, in The Wealth of Nations, opposed the mercantile doctrine. The partisans of mercantilism think that the wealth of states implies the accumulation of precious metals, like gold and silver, in the expense of the trading partners. On the contrary, Adam Smith thinks that the source of wealth is pacific free trade and mutual benefits of all the trading partners. Smith is the first one to demonstrate in a scientific way that the European nations could prosper in harmony. The proximity of wealthy nations in the neighborhood is not an obstacle to become wealthy. On the contrary, this proximity is a factor which accelerates and strengthens this economic improvement. Adam Smith was disconsolate about, as I said, the ancestral feud between France and England, and the obstacle and bans of every description that indirect trade between those two countries. Because what we call returns would have been swift and forthcoming, English capital invested in colonies would have been 3 to 4 more times profitable should they have been used to trade with France. For matters of principle and for the sake of economic rationality, he urged the English to give up their empire. He wanted to get rid of colonies of England, or at the very least, to allow the colonies to freely select their own economic partners. So it took ages to consecrate this kind of idea with the General Agreement of Tariff and Trade, or actually the creation of the World Trade Organizations, which has made the Smith's dreams come true. In the last quarter of the 18th century, the economy was already active and buoyant on the world stage, but exchange remained subjected to all kinds of, as I told you, of barriers, assorted bans, tariffs, and other preferences linked to colonial system. Adam Smith considered that the discovery of America and the passage to the Eastern Indies through the Cape of Good Hope were two of the most remarkable and important events recorded in the annal of mankind. The march toward globalization had begun, but while it should have contributed to peace and prosperity, it brought, of course, along with it violence, injustice, and persecution. Why? Because it went its own way, hand in hand with the colonial system. At the time these discoveries were made, Europeans enjoyed such superior power that they could get away with every kind of injustice. they committed in this unexplored area. But Adam Smith viewed this occurrence with optimism, estimating that these calamities were to be considered as the collateral damages of the great event and not a natural consequence. Given time, the different parts of the world will probably reach an equal level of power, and the reciprocal fear that this balance will inspire will induce everyone to respect the otherwise. So we are still a bit far from this period, but it's not a very naive conception. A plea for at this period, he was already pleading for outsourcing. Arguments in favor of outsourcing can already be found in Adam Smith's work. He noted that some entrepreneurs considered it far more beneficial to invest in what we could call the third world today. Why? Because the profit they made was greater. The rate of profit was higher in the colony. What Adam Smith really explained very well in that is that, despite appearances to the contrary, the individual interest of the entrepreneur tally here with the public interest of the country to which it belongs. Why? A high rate of profit is the signal given to entrepreneurs that capital is in short supply somewhere. It is the signal that goods are being purchased cheaper and are being sold at price above their actual value. It is also often the signal that a category of people is being oppressed. Why? Because in this part of the world, people work for a price which is inferior of the value of their work. The attraction of capitals toward this part of the world will raise the competition between entrepreneurs present in this part of the world. This competition will quickly raise the cost of labor because, of course, workers will work for the entrepreneurs who give them the best wage. The rate of profit will reach to a normal level, and the price of the goods produced will raise in the same proportion of the wages. The imported goods will be more expensive in the country where the entrepreneurs come from, and the difference price between the goods imported and the goods manufactured in the country will gradually vanish. So if you apply this kind of reasoning to the contemporary world, the Chinese products, if they are allowed to be sold in a market, will probably go higher and higher because with the time. European colonial trade was considerably jeopardized by the mercantile school that Adam Smith so relentlessly opposed. Because of this policy, international trade was submitted to a whole range of limitation, hindrance, and prohibition. The exchanges were submitted to a double monopoly. First one, the monopoly imposed by the metropolis to its colonies. They can trade the colonies only with the metropolis and not with other countries. These colonies were not allowed to trade with other colonies or between themselves. And the metropolis becomes, of course, the obliged intermediary and the exclusive provider of the colonies. Second monopoly, it's a monopoly rather more insidious. It's the monopoly that the metropolis impose to each national tradesman, the exclusive monopoly. What does that mean? A company, called the exclusive company, receives from the state the privilege to trade exclusively with the colonies. All European countries had an exclusive company. It was always called, as you know, Company of Eastern India, or Company of Eastern India, etc. In every country, you had a colony like that. So the tradesmen of the country of the metropolis could enter in this company, but this one structured like a medieval corporation, and the admittance was extremely regulated. So these joint stock companies were thus in a position to raise considerable amounts of money. For instance, the South Sea Company, an English one, could at one moment in time avail itself of a capital that was equivalent to more than three times the amount of the capital dividend account of the Bank of England. This company was managed by a board of directors submitted to the control of a general assembly of owners who, for the most part, hardly had any clue about the business of the company at hand, whose only concern was to be paid a dividend every 6 months or every year without having to get involved in any way. Looks familiar, doesn't it? So, at the other extremity, the agents of the company were most of the time dishonest and corrupted. They wanted to build a personal fortune and come back in the metropolis. For those reasons, most of those companies went bankrupt. Most of those companies received exorbitant privilege from the government. The state gave it subsidies, primes, subventions. The state protected it, paid it debts, but no one at the end could avoid bankruptcy. So the exclusive trade, the protectionist trade, is a very nocive one. It's not liberal trade. But Adam Smith remarked that it would be an economic disaster for English industry, and trade should those companies living on the state drip be removed in one big suite. So to dismantle the exclusive trade, we should act gradually. So we are still actually in a situation which is a bit comparable at the situation of this time. So as we can see, the problem of the companies too big to fail and the problem of systemic risk are very old problems. These problems are all as old as the crony capitalism. What is crony capitalism? Crony capitalism is not capitalism. Crony capitalism is a situation when the state is corrupted by companies and when companies are corrupted by the states. On the contrary, a genuine capitalism is a capitalism where the division between companies and the state is clear and respected. A clear separation between, for instance, Goldman Sachs and the administration of Obama. But it's maybe a dream. It was the dream of Adam Smith. Okay. I just will slip a few parts. Unlike what is often asserted, the urge to achieve unlimited wealth is not sterile. This urge to become wealthier results in an improvement of everyone's condition in satisfying the needs of the entire population. It is socially beneficial. Why? Because this accumulation of wealth is not something made in the expense of the poor people. This accumulation of wealth has a name. It is called capital. The process that leads to its establishment is called saving. This is precisely where Adam Smith's way of thinking changes in relation to his first book, The Theory of Moral Sentiments. In this last opus, following the Scottish tradition and thinkers like Bernard de Mandeville, Adam Smith explained it was the spending of the wealthy that gave the poor work, and conversely, the luxury industry was beneficial for the poor. He will change of his ideas, because these ideas is still very medieval ideas with big palaces and with big owners. In the wealth of nation, his perspective changes. The wealthy do not contribute most of the well-being of society by their extravagantly expensive lifestyle. His lifestyle is not the explanation of the beneficial effect on the society. Generally, the wealthy doesn't spend far, far more than the average person in comparison with the money it implies. It is the fact that they build capital that can be mobilized to create new rich that the unlimited desire of the wealthy to accumulate become a cause of enrichment for society. This was no longer about poor workers making a profit out the goods they supply to the palace and of the wealthy. It was the wage earners finding employment in the factories created thanks to the capital of the wealthy. So Adam Smith wrote The Wealth of Nations to prove this moral truth. The urge for unlimited enrichment is compatible with the common interest. How can this be possible? The increase of genuine riches is the result of progress in the division of labor. Accumulated goods are advanced by the wealthy to the workers in the shape of goods, salaries, and means of production. These goods advanced to the workers are the capital. The workers are going to reproduce these goods in greater numbers. The difference between goods advanced by the wealthy to the worker and the goods produced by the worker has a name. It's called profit. The aim of the master is to obtain the highest profit. How to increase this profit? By increasing gradually the number of workers and to make them, these people, richer than they were before. So to understand clearly the difference between this old conception of enrichment and this new one, this new revolutionary one, which is the beginning of the market economy, we could explain it with a contemporary illustration. Let's imagine some Saudi princes living in opulence. They live in palaces surrounded by huge parks established in the desert. They live with domestics, friends, cousins, etc. They meet expensive feasts. We could say that they contribute to the propagation of the world in all the class of society. They give money to the plumber and goldsmiths to install gold taps in the bathroom. They give money to architects, to painters who reproduce Venetian houses in front of the swimming pool. They give money to technicians who take care of the fleet of Rolls Royce, Jaguar, Bentley, etc. They give money to the golf trainers, to aviators, to riding professors, etc. Bernard de Mandeville will say that the industry of princes is in the advantage of the public good because the money goes to the poor. Adam Smith would not say that. Adam Smith would say that the princes are destroying the wealth. They destroy the capital. Why? Because they spent, they wasted without doing anything to reproduce them. If the society was composed exclusively of extravagant people like that, it will go quickly bankrupt. Of course, the money exchange does slip into the hands of a third party, and the money is circulating. That's not the question. But the counterpart of this money evaporates as soon as it begins to be used. So the Saudi princes who choose instead of waste their wealthy to invest it to diverse companies to finance interesting projects and profitable projects, for instance, I don't know, in Africa, projects who employs a lot of workers could reproduce the capital because the project will generate profits and then new capital. And so it will reproduce and reproduce. Economically, this second choice allows the reproduction and the increase of wealth. Morally speaking, this choice is better than the first one because it improves the situation of more people in the earth. So as we have said, Adam Smith opposed the mercantilist school. I think I will just slip this part. I will quickly explain what mercantilism is. You have two big rules in mercantilism, which I remind you is the conception was before the liberalism conception, economical conception of Adam Smith. To discourage the export of the factories, raw material in the hope of promoting the export and products of a greater value, and secondly, it is essential to encourage the import of manufacturers' raw materials in order to give national workers the opportunity to transform themselves for a lower cost and thereby reduce the import of costly manufactured goods. So this theory, the true matrix of protectionism, has been applied to the international trade at the period before Adam Smith. Because in this conception, they make an error. Actually, money fulfills two functions. It is an instrument of trade, money, first one. And second one, it is a measure of values. This double nature gave rise to the popular idea that the money makes riches, or that riches is tantamount to an abundance of gold and silver. We say it of a wealthy man that he owns a lot of silver money, and we say it of a poor man that he lacks silver money. To get rich means to get silver money in this conception. In usual languages, wealth and silver are considered as synonymous. The advocates of mercantilism eventually adopted the same way of reasoning in terms of national wealth. A rich country, in this conception, is a country where which money is abundant. It is therefore important to hoard stacks of gold and silver in one own country. This explains why the first thing that concerned the Spanish and Portuguese conquistadors when they landed on unknown shores was to find the location of gold and silver war deposits. This is not unlike Genghis Khan's Tartars, who used to ask whether cattle and sheep could be found in abundance in the Kingdom of France. They looked for cattle and sheep. Why? Because for these pastoral people who were not familiar with the use of money, cattle fulfilled the same monetary function as the latter. Like the Spaniards, they mistook the instrument of trade for that of wealth. This explains why, under the influence of these views, the various European nations strove toward gold and silver. Portugal and Spain had prohibited the exportation of precious metals outside, or had put very strong limitations to export it. All this is quite useless. It was quite useless. Why? So, according to Adam Smith, if a state does not produce any wine, all it needs to do is to buy this wine abroad. Likewise, if a country has no gold or silver mines, it can buy it abroad just as any other goods. It is the good you could find very easily. Because of its smallness, it can be carried quickly from one place to another place. A state who produces wealth will never lack anything, because the state could exchange wealth with anything else, gold and silver included. If the amount of gold and silver is in a given country exceeds its needs, no government in the world, whoever vigilant and zealous it is in position to prevent this export. Precious metal coming from Peru and Brazil, in Spain and Portugal, were always escaping from those countries. If the quantity is inferior of the demand in a country, the government doesn't have to care about it. The precious metal will arrive automatically, and the government could be unable to stop this flow. So the discovery of America did not make Europe rich because it enabled it to import gold and silver. It was not a question to have more gold and silver, which made them rich. It enriched Europe because it gave it an almost inexhaustible new market in which it was able to sell its goods. This increase in demand accelerated the division of labor, brought about new development in industry, increased productive power, multiplied wealth and the real income per capita. This resulted in a flow of new products to America and of new goods to Europe. So there is, according to Adam Smith, in one of, because the Wealth of Nation, you have five books in the Wealth of Nation, but what in one of his book, he make a short history of Europe, economic history of Europe. And he speaks about a natural order of things. The natural course of events steers to capital, the capital of a fledgling society towards agriculture. Then, you must firstly develop agriculture. Then, factories, and finally, foreign trade. Adam Smith suggested that economic development in Europe did not follow the natural order of things because of a feudal interlude, the feudality, that lasted more than 1,000 years and that was responsible for leaving most of the land in this vast territory, I mean Europe, I mean the country we are now, not the country, but the continent we are now, they're leaving most of the land almost totally barren. Vast expanse of uncultivated land just fell into the hands of a few families, and the possibility of dividing them was prevented by resorting to every imaginable trick in the books. So it was impossible to divide the territory because of the law of the feudality. So the problem was that agreed landowners was never concerned by the improvement of his land, never bothered to cultivate nor upgrade it. He wanted to increase his authority, defend his territory, or conquer the territory of his neighbor. Improve his land implies a capital, and most of the time, he didn't have capital. Why? Because his personal expense required the spending of all his income, and even more. So this required the greatest attention and small gains and the smallest savings. I will just slip a few paragraphs. So, where no foreign trade nor factories existed, the only way to spend the surplus of agricultural production was for the lord who owned it to consume the whole of it at home and thereby care for the upkeep of hundreds, if not thousands, of people living in owns land. It is said that the Count of Warwick, the English Count of Warwick, was giving food every day to 30,000 persons in his different castle. Maybe it's a bit exaggerated, but it's still a good signal. All these poor people were totally submitted to him because they had no other way to spend the production of the agricultural land before trade exists. However, the slow and unfeeling action of foreign trade and of manufacturers succeeded where feudal laws had dismally failed. Oh, by supplying major landowners with a vast amount of luxuries and commodities, they could only acquire by exchanging the surplus produce of their land. So money makes, according to this view of Adam Smith, money makes people free. In the system of wages and labor force, every service is paid with money. Giving money is a way to extinct immediately every link of acknowledgement, of feudal acknowledgement. So you give a salary, you give a wage, so there is an exchange, and the symmetry between the two persons is perfect. And you kill the acknowledgement, and you kill the dependency between men. So it makes sense to make saving. Saving is indeed a fundamental value of economic liberalism. There can be no capitalism without capital. It's a big problem today. The latter is acquired by developing the spirit of thrift. According to Adam Smith, a nation whose traders and bankers become arrogant, as was the case in Spain and Portugal at the time of their colonial empires, will see its economy founder because it will have lost the sense of economic realities. Adam Smith is Scottish. Increase his capital is, according to him, a moral imperative. He must be clearly understood in this connection. The finality is not essentially, is not to become richer, it's not the finality, but to create more wealth in the world. It is the finality, create more wealth in the world. By this means, we put in place some activities who employs and increase an increasing number of persons who manage to take care of themselves and generate new capitals. Increase the capital means to give a job to an increasing number of persons. People working are people with purchasing power. It means people freer. It means more liberty. Economic liberalism is therefore not an end in itself. The end goal is freedom. The more freedom we have on earth, the more it requires a developed society. So, as we can see, Adam Smith's book is not just another plea for profit. It has often been said that liberalism seeks profit for its profit's sake. While liberalism does indeed promote the accumulation of wealth that cannot be dissociated from the growth and of prosperity within society. Its final goal is not to generate an higher rate of profit. In reality, Adam Smith was hostile to high rates of profits that would inevitably stem from interventionist measures and would be so maintained. These artificial rates favors merchants and manufacturers at the expense of consumers. A high rate of profit is just a signal given to investors, allowing them to come and invest their capitals in whatever economic activity they choose, not the state has to choose it, and profit is not an end in itself. It is a signal to put an end to this situation. It is a signal to put an end to this situation. The concentration of capitals means the entrance of this in this market of a larger number of competitors. After a while, the rate of profit comes to a normal level. Besides, an high rate of profit has the effect to destroy the spirit of thrift which is natural for the tradesman. The vanishing of this spirit has lost the tradesman of Cadix and Lisbon. Thank you.